Roshan coming from Slovenia. And yes, during this day, while there were so many talks about DNSSEC, Andrew asked Mark and me to help him enable the DNSSEC validation on his public resolvers, and he did it. So congratulations. So back to my presentation. First of all, acknowledgement. So I work for Internet Society, but and I would like to thank Internet Society for letting me spend some of my working time in my lab. I'm running the Go6lab. That's the IPv6 lab back at home, and where I'm testing IPv6 stuff, IPv6 implementations. And lately, I also started doing the DNSSEC stuff. Me being the IPv6 guy, well, mostly for the last decades, I had no clue about DNSSEC. Well, I knew theoretically how it works, but it all seemed very, very complex and complicated to me. So I decided, because I'm sort of pragmatic and practical person, I thought of, okay, I will set it up. I will sign my domains and see how it works in reality, right, in practice. Actually, the source of all this was Matthijs Mekkink. He's one of the main developers for OpenDNSSEC platform. And he asked me once at one ITF meeting, he said, Jan, why Go6.sa is not signed? And then I said, because when I'm reading through all this complex academic stuff about DNSSEC, I don't understand how it works. And if you write me a very to the point operational document, how to install DNSSEC, how to sign a domain, and how to do it, I will do it. And he actually did that. So we went through that document, did the corrections, and now it's a public document, as you will see. So how I did it in my network. So I'm using the PowerDNS server. It was also used before as a primary for non-signed zones. I'm using the OpenDNSSEC platform in the middle, like a bump in the wire for signing domains. And then I'm using Bind9 DNS servers as secondaries to the OpenDNS to serve the signed zones. Virtualization used is a Proxmox 3.4, and the OS templates are Fedora 20 and CentOS 6 and 7. So I need to fix this implementation. I'm also using other authoritative DNS servers now for the diversity. If one fails, then the other might survive. As I said, DNSSEC is bumping a wire. I have two public primary servers, and this is the concept. Hidden primary transfers home to the open DNSSEC. Implementation documents that Matthijs wrote, and it was tested in my network. You can find it in this URL. If you just follow these documents, you will have your zones signed and DSS published or DNSTs published, and be simply done with it. It is fairly easy, basically. And to be really honest, I actually understood how DNSSEC actually works after I implemented it, and after I'm running it for quite a while. And two days ago, I did my first KSK rollover for Zorz.si domain, and it survived. It did not disappear from the internet, so it's not a big thing. Yeah, it works. It's fairly easy. And again, with Matthijs, we wrote a document together how to do a KSK rollover for the operators that don't want to know this gibberish around complex stuff. So once I had the DNSSEC, then I said, okay, how to enhance this stuff? How to enhance the security? And then I heard some talks about DANE, and why not try it, right? let's discover some new things. And then I said, okay, I have DNSSEC signed domains, and I have been using postfix for forever, basically. I spent my last 20 years in operations building the internet networks. So I decided to use a postfix, the new one, 3.0.1, and set it up as is described in the README file for TLS, and I set it up for DANE validation. Next thing to do is a TLSA record. You heard a lot about TLSA today, and this is the TLSA record for my MX record. So I decided to do DANE for email systems first, because there is an implementation. Unluckily, we don't have the DANE validation in the browsers yet by default. You can load some additional modules in the browsers, but it's not there yet. So I decided to do it for email. So this is the TLSA record. As you see, the selectors in OpenStack is 301. This is the most common one that you will see for DANE. Majority of people uses 301. And this is basically hash of a TLS certificate that I'm serving from mx.go6lab.si. You can read more about DANE on this URL. So how does it work? First, when you ask your DNS resolver, it does the DNSSEC validation, and then it starts. Then the MTA sends back the TLS, right? It's start TLS and start TLS, and then the DANE magic happens. Your sending server asks the validating resolver for TLSA, gets back the TLSA, and if the hash from the TLS certificate and TLSA matches, then this is the correct remote server, and the machine is ready to deliver your email. So, as this first version of this presentation was done for our Slovenian knob, so there is lots of data for Slovenia in there. But mxgo6lab.si was able to verify TLS cert to T2, that's one of the providers in my country, and NLNet Labs, and also some others. So we did some testing. These are copy-paste from the log. Of course, the first one to think of who to send an email, and you know that he's using DANE, is Benno from NLNet Labs. So I did the initial tests with him. And this is the postfix config. If you want that your postfix is using DANE, then you need to put this stuff in. It's fairly simple. Be advised that 2.11 and up is needed of a postfix, or 3.0 or higher version of a postfix. So, okay. I have the system that is working. Now what? Let's do some more tests, right? So I decided to do a malform TLSA record. How to do that? You publish the TLSA record and just change one character in the hash. And that should be malformed TLSA record. Well, TLSA record by itself is not malformed, but the hash does not match the TLSA certificate anymore. So, what happens? It says untrusted TLSA connection established, and then it says drop the connection, server certificate not trusted. Even though if you set up the opportunistic encryption, and usually your machine trusts the untrusted, well, the certificates that are self-signed, if you set up DANE, and there is a TLSA record, and the hash does not match the hash of the TLS, the certificate on the mail server, it will refuse to deliver email, and that's basically the only right decision of the mail server. Because if there is a TLSA and doesn't match, something is wrong. So good. Okay, next thing that I asked myself one day when I woke up was how many people on the internet uses DANE? Am I alone on this planet? Me and Benno from the ML MATLABs, or is there anybody else? And I said, okay, is there a database where I can go and test against? And then I figured out there is Alexa top 1 million domains. These are big domains. But okay, and I downloaded the whole thing, and I wrote the script. And this is bash scripting from hell to write. It is quite an extensive and long test. So what I decided to do, to send an actual email to non-existing email address at all these 1 million domains. That means 1 million sessions. And then go into the log file and figure out what's going on, what the results are. And this is not theory. This has been done. The script was running for 15 days. But I saw that the logs are filling in, and I was patient enough to wait until it was the end, and then actually, no, the logs were filled in much earlier. The analyze of the log was running for 15 days, because there is lots of data in there. So the result, out of 1 million domains, 992,000 of them had MX record and actually mail server. It's quite a lot. So now the shocking news, nearly 70% of all attempted SMTP sessions were encrypted with TLS in any shape or form. Trusted, untrusted, verified, anonymous, and so on. So today, if you're using an email server that is using the TLS encryption in any kind of form, 70% of email traffic can be encrypted. I think this is quite a good result. I was expecting a lot lower number. So, and this is also shocking to me that the majority of TLS connections, 60%, were established with trusted certificate. That means that people paid money to one of the CAs to get sort of a trusted certificate. Wow. And okay, 1,382 connections where remote server announced TLS capability failed with cannot start TLS handshake failure. These people will not receive many emails, especially if the other end is encrypting. But hey, it's email. It's a postcard, right? Yeah. I keep saying this for the last 20 years. Email, according to RFC 822 and 821, is the equivalent of a postcard. You send it, everybody can read it, and it comes if it comes. Right? Okay, more results. TLS established connection ratios. So there is anonymous 109,000, untrusted 167,000, trusted 410,000, and wow, verified 128. So 128 sessions were actually DANE verified. I was ecstatic. I said, "Oh, I'm not alone in this universe." Some people is using DANE. Wow. Okay, there's a quick guide. What is anonymous? It's opportunistic TLS with no signature, untrusted. Is that pure certificate is signed by not trusted CA, known as self-signed, and trusted, which is pure certificate signed by trusted CA, and of course verified is verified by DANE. So verified 128. And I hope that this number will start growing and growing. I need to rewrite part of the testing mechanism, but I will probably rerun this thing every 2 months or three, so I can compare the results. And some mail distribution, so top 10, google.com is handling like 125,000 domains, secureserver.net, QQ, Yandex, and so on. So let's see, google.com is using trusted certificate, secure server is some trusted, some no TLS at all, then QQ.com is no TLS, Yandex is trusted, and so on and so forth. So it's a mix of these things. And these are the biggest email servers that are handling like a lot of domains. But when we come to DNSSEC and DANE, none of them are DNSSEC signed. And that means no DANE for them possible. And that means no DANE for anyone using those servers. Not the boys. They need to work on it. Okay. And then I got bored again after these 15 days of analyzing and doing this stuff. And I said, okay, when do they pay? How do I test the corner cases when things fail, right? I ask myself sometimes, but in this case, of course, with wrong certificate hash in TLSA, it refuses to send mail. So here is the ambiguous one. If a domain where MX records resides is not DNSSEC signed, there is no validation according to POSIX. The DANE verification just quits. It says, I cannot trust the MX record because it's in non-signed zone, and I will just refuse to do DANE validation. We will come back to this later. Okay, if TLSA record published in non-DNSSEC zone, so of course, if TLSA record is non-signed, then you can't trust it anyhow. So the DANE verification fails. And this is also, well, it's not the biggest one, but anyway. The previous one is a bit more ambiguous because it's an implementation question. So, for example, Go6lab zone.si is signed, so it's mx.go6lab.si. That's A and quad A record, right? And there is TLSA for mx.go6lab.si also signed. My domain Zorz.si is also signed, and mx points to mx.go6lab.si. For a specific reason, I also have the domain ncc.si. Is not signed because I want to have at least one domain that is not signed for testing purposes. And MX for this domain points to mx.go6lab.si. And when you send email to yarn@zorz.si and yarn@ncc.si, guess what happens? Who would like to guess? With yarn@zorz.si, everything is verified because everything is signed. But when you send an email to a domain that is not signed, but pointing MX to a signed zone, do you think that DANE works or not? It doesn't. Now, the big question is, and this will be a discussion in next Yokohama ITF meeting, probably in the DANE working group. By specification, by standard, DANE verifies the endpoint. So if there is an MX record or if there is the A record in the zone and there is a TLSA record and the TLS certificate is presented, DANE should just do the matching. it is not supposed to be a path validation. Like RPKR is not a path validation, it's the origin validation, right? So my operational mindset tells me that my mail server cannot trust the MX record in non-sign zone. But looking at the RFCs, it says that there is a domain name, and there is a TLSA, and there is a certificate, so it should be verified. So now we will start the discussion if this implementation actually is built correctly according to specification, or we need to use some common sense or change the specification or what to do. So this will be some discussion going on probably. So you see, with these experiments, when I wake up and ask myself things, sometimes I'm useful. Now we start with a discussion and let's see where this will lead. So yeah, this is what I said. When you send an email to signed zone, there is a verified TLS connection. And when I send an email to DANE@NCCLSI, there is anonymous TLS connection because the DANE verification just drops when it receives the non-signed MX records. Then I did some testing for Slovenia. This is probably not very interesting for you. I extracted the Slovenian domain names, and we had lower numbers, but it doesn't matter. Lots of people is using TLS. And okay, 10% of them were over IPv6. That's good. And just 44 servers out of 500 are using no TLS at all. I checked 610 domains, and there are 35 DNSSEC signed domains. So it's pretty cool. Okay, I will skip this. So, conclusions. 70% of email today can be encrypted in some way. You still need to set up your mail server to start using the encryption and start encrypting in any possible way it can. There's a low number of DNSSEC signed domains and servers, and even lower number of DANE TLSA verified servers and connections. And it's easy. Just go and implement it and test it. If I can do it, everybody can do it, right? So with this, any questions, protests, suggestions, complaints?
Mark Alkins. For web sites, you should use 301. The zero implies you're looking at the whole certificate. For mail, and this comes from Victor, the mind behind whether you should look at just the endpoint or the connection to the endpoint as well, and it was the MX record. Victor told me, use 311. I'm not going to argue with him, but he says you just look at the binary stuff and not necessarily the start and endpoint dates of the certificate, just binary data itself. In other words, if you use 311 for mail, the certificate will still work fine after the expiry date of the certificate, which is probably what you want.
Okay, I will change this and test and redo the test. No problem. Any other questions? Suggestions? What else should we test? Sometimes I wake up in the morning and say, hey, let's do another test in the lab. I need more suggestions.
You mentioned the last point of your slide was that we should just do it and do a trial. Going back to two or three slides, you mentioned that if a non-signed zone points towards a signed zone, the MX records from NCC.SI, how do you get around that then? Because most mail servers, specifically in the ISP environment, answer for a lot of different zone paths.
it's very easy to go around. You sign all your zones and the zones can be done with it.
We don't have an ISP, we don't always host all our zones.
That
point towards our ML servers.
So let me try to start this discussion in at the next ISTF in Yokohama to see if the implementation is wrong or specification needs to be changed. Because now, so I'm completely ambiguous here. I'm completely ambivalent. Because my operational mindset tells me verify everything, verify the whole chain. But the specifications does not mention that. Right? So if you did not sign your zone where the MX record is resigning, then I don't know. In my mind, you should have the whole chain of trust. You should.
On the postfix, because he's talking about mail servers, on their documentation, it actually specifies you need to define the difference between DANE only, and you can allow it to actually accept opportunistic TLS to accept if it fails the verification. So, which is an option because it's highly experimental.
Yes, I tested with all three of them, well, two of them, DANE and DANE only. And with DANE only, the documentation is a bit ambivalent and says, I understood that DANE only would be, if DANE is verified, then deliver. If there is no TLSA record, then whatever. No, DANE only means that if there is no TLSA record, it was, and maybe more. If you set DANE, not DANE only, then this is the behavior. Validate, if validation fails, drop the session. If there is no TLSA, just use the normal way of a TLSA record. But yeah, this question with assigned and non-signed and the path validation and this will probably spark some discussion somewhere. So the question back, what would you like to see that if the MX is in non-signed zone, that your mail server still verifies the remote mail server or not?
From a commercial aspect, being an ISP, I think it has to. Because we can't drop our customers' mails because they don't have signed zone paths. You could do something like a warning in a subject. So just thinking off the top of my head here, just put something in a subject warning your zone files not signed, but something like that would actually be Greek to most people, and they would just think this is spam and deleted, so they wouldn't really worry about it.
No, hang on. I think we're talking about, we didn't understand each other very well. If that happens, but then validation does not say failed, and drops the connection, it just silently exits and let the rest of the postfix system to do the TLS stuff and actually delivers email. It just DANE validation does not validate, just exit zero, and you know the rest of the mechanism does what it's supposed to do.
So I'm taking it from two aspects. One is the person is wanting to implement DANE across the board, saying that whoever's zone files on signed, you need to warn them and get them to try and zone. How do you get them to, how do you get everyone to sign the zone files? So that's the track I was going down that road. Because if, as an ISP, if I host all my zone files that for my customers, I can encourage them to sign their zone files. Customers whose DNS records and zone files I have no control over, it's up to them. I need to encourage them to do it. So, yes, one does need to accept mail from anyone, and then hopefully encourage or use a slowly but surely to sign their zones.
Okay, so would that be an encouragement, or if we make the specification that MX being in a signed zone is not necessary? Would that be an accelerator for people signing the domain, the domains? Okay. Yeah.
Thank you, Sanfa. One of the things that's likely becoming very useful for smart customers is this thing called Cloudflare, that do your CDN, your DNS, and all those sort of funny nice things for you. And then they take over your DNS on your behalf. There's not an easy way, the discussion that I'm thinking of is that if you host your own domain on the domain server, that server that is inside the DNS sign zone, that should be verified, yes. But that NCC pointing to that server, because it's not in the sign zone, that does not need to be verified. But the actual server that you are pointing to, that's inside the sign DNS, DNSSEC zone, that should be even verified on the DANE side of things. So now the question goes that, yes, that NCC, why isn't that signed? Because people can't necessarily sign it. Things like, for example, Cloudflare. Now, to get the email, do they need that way to allow the verification on the sign zone, but then allow the others to point to a non-sign zone to be able to point to a sign zone to be able to go through? It makes the operational sense in my mind, given that sort of environment that we're starting to go through.
Okay, I will. Thank you for this suggestion. I will carry it on with me to Yokohama discussion. Any more questions, suggestions? Megan is signing me that I'm out of air.
Hey, it's your lunch break.
In a diverse language.
Last one. One of the things that, is a good trend is, we're getting to a point where in 5 years, 10 years time, end-to-end communication is likely to be encrypted between hosts. But there are legitimate times when we want to redirect, to capture portals or other interception mechanisms and redirect to different sites. Is there any mechanism within DANE that allows for this to be done legitimately?
Did not think about that yet, but we can talk. Yeah, maybe Joe.
Yeah, I don't think there is. I think that the push is to try and find different mechanisms. And the most recent one I saw was Warren from Ari has adopted the idea, which introduces a new DHCP option. So as well as giving your IP address, we can give the client a URI and say, this is the URI you must go to in order to register on this network. And it's not implemented anywhere, and it's not at all clear that the spec is good, but it's another way of doing it. And this is kind of an interesting one, because it's doing it at layer 3 instead of layer 2. All the layer 2 approaches have kind of failed.
And some of the lines of a hotspot 2.0 for a wide network.
Okay.
Any other questions? Once.
Lunch.
Lunch. Thank you very much.